Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. In this video, we're going to learn about long-run production and economic growth around the world. In order to do so, we're going to start by defining what is the long run in macroeconomics. Then, we're going to review the concept of economic growth as well as its main drivers. And finally, we'll analyze economic growth around the world. That is, how are countries performing in terms of long-run production? This will allow us to make comparisons over different countries and economies, establishing what we have learned so far and what is here to learn. So let's begin. So this video is about long-run production. We know that this is equivalent to a significant period of time, but what does that mean in macroeconomics? The first thing that we have to keep in mind is price flexibility. Price flexibility is not the same for all goods and services. That is why in macroeconomics, we use an assumption in order to simplify and establish the difference between the short run and the long run. This assumption consists on the fact that the prices of final products sold to consumers are more flexible than input prices. In other words, the cost of each factor of production used to produce a final good or service is more inflexible in the short term than the price of the final good itself. What's the most common example? Wages. Wages are the payments for labor, which is an input used for most final products. Wages have two main qualities. They are adjusted periodically and not automatically. And they have downward inflexibility, which means as they adjust, they are unlikely to be reduced. Those qualities are significantly different from final products, which can adjust their prices more quickly. So, the short run consists on the time horizon over which the wages and prices of other inputs to production are inflexible. Within this time frame, it is assumed that there may be imbalances, since some prices may have adjusted to changes in market conditions, those of the final products, while others have not, those of the inputs. And the long run consists on the period of time over which these input prices have time to adjust. In this case, the overall price level, contractual wage rates, and expectations are fully adjusted in equilibrium, which allows us to make analysis regarding GDP and general prices. Now that we understand the concept of long run, let's see how that applies to economic growth. Economic growth is defined by an increase in the market value of the goods and services that an economy produces over time. It is measured as the percentage rate in the real gross domestic product. Why real domestic product? Because this indicator seeks to capture whether there is genuine growth in the total output by isolating the impact of inflation. So, one country can experience economic growth from one year to another. That is, if the real GDP has increased over a certain period of time. However, if we want to talk about the long run, this growth has to occur long enough for our prices to adjust. So long-run economic growth consists on a sustained rise in the quantity of goods and services that an economy produces. Many economists theorized about what makes an economy grow in a sustained manner. Among the main debates, we can extract three main factors. First of all, growth of productivity. It is associated to the availability of physical capital or the fact that the cost of products decreases as production rises. In other words, the optimization or minimization of the costs related to the inputs. Secondly, demographic changes. The population structure can be crucial. For example, a higher educated population can lead to higher industrialization and higher GDP. It is also important to keep in mind the ratio between demographic growth and the availability of natural resources. Finally, the labor force participation or the size of its workforce. Sustainable growth requires an equilibrium between these factors. Each factor is not always enough. For example, when population growth is the only factor driving GDP growth, rather than changes in supply, demand, or revenue, the growth can be excessive, An economy must satisfy the demands of the population in order to succeed: supply, demand, revenue, and employment. When demographic expansion is higher than the employment reaction rate, for example, the economy is unable to keep up, leading to higher unemployment rates and eventually worse standards of living. Now it's time for a quick exercise. A country has made long-term investments on education and healthcare. As a result, its population has become more skilled and has a higher life expectancy, and has achieved sustained economic growth. Which driver is boosting economic growth? If you answer demographic changes, you are correct. Remember, having a more skilled labor force can be a key incentive for economic growth. This raises a very important question. Is there a unique path towards long economic growth? If every country follows the same recipe, creating a sustainable mix between productivity, workforce participation, and demographic expansion, will they all reach the same results? Since 1950, most countries have been able to achieve sustained economic growth. For example, average income in the richest country during 1950 is now the average income of the average person in the world. This is evidence for global progress in terms of long-run economic growth. This not only has economic consequences, long-run economic growth can also lead to social progress, that means better standards of living. One fact that helps to demonstrate this is that life expectancy now is only 1 year less than in the richest countries during 1950, which is 71 years. This progress is also associated to overcoming malnutrition, poor health, and precarious working conditions. But does this long-run global economic growth mean that everyone is achieving better standards of living? Even though economic growth has been achieved in most countries, there are some downturns. In order to measure that, we had to take into account each country's population. A first approach would be to calculate real GDP per capita, so as to compare GDP growth to population growth. That information provides us the fact that although countries did get wealthier, in some cases GDP did not grow at the same pace as population. This means that GDP does not show us information about the standards of living. So the answer to our question would be, no, it does not. Although we have observed global progress in terms of total and average income, this is not enough evidence for us to conclude that long-run economic growth implies better standards of living for everyone. This is because of two factors. Some countries did not achieve long-run growth, for example, in the Central African region. And also, we are talking about average income. This assumes that when income increases, it is equally distributed. This is a big assumption, and it's not always true. That is why there is a separate discipline to analyze this correlation, which is called development economics. Which are the most common mistakes? First of all, bear in mind that if we analyze economic growth in the long run, we assume to be in equilibrium. That is, all prices are adjusted, input prices and the final products prices. When we discuss real GDP globally, we are comparing in terms of income. This means we are not discussing their standards of living. We are only analyzing total and average wealth. Economic growth can imply higher quality of life, but it's not guaranteed, at least not for everyone. Remember that every country has its own population and its own demographic structure. We've seen in this video how do economies grow. It mainly has three drivers: productivity growth, demographic changes, and labor force participation. Every country has different contexts, institutions, and productive structures. However, since the 1950s, most countries have achieved sustained growth. Unfortunately, this does not mean that it was equally distributed and that everyone achieved better standards of living. In order to measure that, there is a discipline called development economics. With this, you may understand what long-run growth stands for and global economic progress during the last decades. Hope you have enjoyed it, and if you want to learn more, please feel free to explore more on Chegg.